got something to say, they can come to school and say. Right. They're going to be negative anyway. They don't, yeah.
Thank you, Gary. Thank you, Jeremy. Wonderful way to bring us into worship this morning. Greetings to each and every one of you in the name of the risen Christ. Good morning, Cathedral of Hope, United Church of Christ.
Good morning.
Wow, that was a wonderful welcome as we gather this morning. We're a joy to welcome you and so glad that you are with us this morning.
And if it's your first time, we would love to meet you. We have a ministry and visitor center area. We'd love to give you a gift, tell you a little bit more about what an amazing, amazing place this is. We do wonderful worship on Sundays and Wednesday nights, but there is so much more that you can get involved in. And so not only looking at the weekly, but we'd love to meet you and give you more information. And so if you're here for the first time, we give you a special welcome.
We also know that there are many ways in which people connect with Cathedral of Hope. Sometimes it's here in worship, and sometimes it's in online. We have about 70,000 people who join us online on a regular basis from over 100 countries around the world. And so we want to welcome each and every one of you as you worship with us this morning. Let's welcome all of those online this day.
Today is the final membership class of 2016. There'll be more in 2017. It sounds very formal and official, but today it's at 3, and we actually have a really good class, but if you're still interested, we have space for you, so please come by and check us out. It's from about 3 to 7:30. It's a great time to connect in a table group. You get to meet people. Many of our lay leaders come and kind of share their different passions with you, and you get to meet a lot of our staff in person, so we'd love to have you today at 3 o'clock.
And I think, Erin, you said that there are 70 people signed up.
Yeah, something like that.
So it's another big class as we bring the end.
I thought after last time we would just have no one left, but apparently people keep coming.
We keep adding as much as we can do. I want to invite you to turn to page 7 of your weekly. You'll find more information about the estate planning seminar that's coming up on Saturday, the 22nd of October at 3:30 in the afternoon. Please note where it is. It's at an estate here in Dallas. There is refreshments, there's valet parking, there's all these sorts of wonderful things that will encourage you to think about how we can leave a legacy to Cathedral of Hope. So please do check out that announcement again on page 7 of your weekly this morning.
And a reminder that All Saints Sunday is November 6th. And if in the last year you have had a loved one who has passed, especially if it's been someone that's been connected here, we would love to honor them on that Sunday. And so what you need to do is look in the weekly, and the date for submission for pictures and information is next Sunday, October 23rd. So if you come on the 6th with a picture, it's not going to be in the slideshow. So we'd love to have you give that to us so that we can organize another beautiful. I actually have never been here for an All Saints Sunday, and I'm really excited to see all the ways in which we honor our legacy here. It's going to be beautiful.
It is the truth, and one of the ways in which we do that, of course, is that we have the opportunity to remember Day of the Dead, especially with our Latino congregation. So please do come, as you'll see some great ways in which we honor all of the cultures that we have here at Cathedral of Hope. I'm grateful for the many women who are reaching out to form the new Women's Council. They'll be meeting for the very first time tomorrow, and the Women's Council will help and inform us about how we continue to be this place of equality and also this place of diversity. So pray for them tomorrow as they meet. Also on page 10, you will find that there is information about the Transgender Council that we're also establishing here at Cathedral of Hope to inform us and to ensure that we do best practice around making sure that our transgender community feel welcome and accepted and a vital part of the Cathedral of Hope. So if you are interested in the Transgender Council, please check out page 10 of your weekly this week.
And we are in our stewardship month, which is a term that we oftentimes know in the church. We have decided to embrace the idea of faithfully giving, faithfully receiving, faithfully experiencing God here. And so if you have experienced the beauty of the divine here, and you have seen the faithfulness of God in this place, this is a time for you to think more broadly and more fully about your giving at Cathedral of Hope. We really rely on those of you who give of your time and your talent, but also of your earnings. That helps our ministries, that helps us grow. And so we'd love to have you think more broadly and more fully about giving during this season. And we're going to have, I think, something at the end of the month that's going to be a special reminder of that. And I also wanted to let you know that next week, I am very excited, a woman named Susan Cottrell is here. How many of you have heard of the book, Mom, I'm Gay? How many of you have said that? Okay. This is a woman who is or was in the evangelical world. Her and her husband are blessed with, I believe, two gay children. And I say it's a blessing. And she says it's a blessing. And she's going to be here. And so if you know of anyone who is a parent, anyone who is a teenager, anyone who has kids, if you have grandkids, this is a great event to come. She's going to talk about her story in a way that's profound and powerful. And it's going to be a great time to connect. And we're hoping to get out of our community a bit and invite some people in. So this is a great time to invite neighbors and people who may not come to a worship service here, but maybe want to hear someone share their story of them being straight and their kids coming out as gay. It's a beautiful, beautiful time, and I encourage you to attend next Sunday.
Definitely. And turn with me on page 12. You will see more information about The Walk. That's our annual three-day retreat that we offer to folks who want to deepen their own spiritual experience through retreat work. You can find out more information about that on page 12. And I believe there is also information in the narthex following worship this morning. So please do think about The Walk in January. We are so blessed this morning to be honoring someone in our congregation who has been a part of our congregation, our church, and our life for many, many years, and not just only here at Cathedral of Hope, but in many, many different organizations around the Dallas community. And we're honoring her today because it's her birthday, and she has been on many events over this last weekend. I wish that I could have joined her, especially on the pub crawl last evening. I understand that she was spotted in many of the establishments on Cedar Springs, rocking and rolling and doing all of those wonderful things. You can check out all of her bio on page 8 of the weekly as we honor today Laurie Masters, who has owned Master Realtors. Yes. We're going to invite Laurie to come and join us on the chancel just for a few moments. But as it says in our weekly, we're going to invite you to come up because we have something to give you this morning. Laurie has been a pioneer for human rights since the age of 20 and has helped create and or found such organizations as the Oasis Drug and Alcohol Program, the Women's Chorus of Dallas, the Extra Mile Awards, and the Women's Motorcycle Club of Dallas.
Yeah, I like that.
She has faithfully served for many years in our community and was also the chair of one of our capital campaigns, our national chair, helping to us to raise vital money for the ongoing ministry and work of the Cathedral of Hope. If you, after worship this evening, we invite you to go and go visit Lee's Garden because there is a new sculpture that's been added over this weekend. It's called The Sacrifice That We Make for Love, and you can see it on the screen this morning if you just want to take a quick look.
It's beautiful.
It honors her story.
Look at it. It's beautiful.
It honors her story and her history of advocacy here in Dallas. One of the folks of our own staff who has known Laurie for a long time, Nita Hattie, is off at the moment. She just had hip replacement and so is at home healing. But she scoured over the last few weeks to find something that was the most appropriate to honor Laurie this morning. And she found this on, I think, eBay. It is the Flying Motorcycle Club of Dallas.
It is.
One of their pins.
It's hard to find.
That you created.
Yeah.
So you'll have plenty of chance to catch up with Laurie in the narthex following worship. But once again, let's honor Laurie Masters this morning.
I love you. I love you, church. I love you. I love you. Mm-hmm. My children.
So you can remain risen because we're now going to share peace with each other. Good morning and welcome.
Good morning and welcome.
Holy Spirit, come to us this day as we worship you. Gather us into this sacred space, and through our own sacredness, create the miracle that is worship. Blessings be, we ask, in Jesus' name. Amen. Please be seated.
Our epistle lesson is from the fourth chapter of Paul's first letter to the church of Corinth. Hear these words. This then is how you ought to regard us, as servants of Christ and as those entrusted with the mysteries God has revealed. Now it is required that those who have been given a trust must prove faithful. I care very little if I am judged by you or any human court. Indeed, I do not even judge myself. My conscience is clear, but that does not make me innocent. It is God who judges me. Therefore, judge nothing before the appointed time. Wait until the Holy One comes, who will bring light to what is hidden in darkness and will expose the motives of the heart. At that time, each will receive their praise from God. May God bless the hearing of these ancient words. Amen.
So during our pastoral prayer, I wanted us to meditate, as we know God is still speaking, on the words of Michelle Obama, which have been much bantered around, the idea that in a world of ugliness, when they go low, we go high. And I thought, what does that mean for us as Christians? What does that mean for us as people of faith? And so what I wanted us to do in this moment of time is to think in our own hearts the ways in which we need to go high, the ways in which, while there is ugliness out there, divisiveness out there, that the road to healing and wholeness and having a high esteem of not only ourselves but the world starts within our own hearts. And so if you'll join with me, we are going to have a moment of silence, and then I'm going to pray for us. But in that moment, what I would like you to do is think in your own heart. Think in your own heart about the ways in which you have allowed that ugliness or that anger or that divisiveness to enter in, and ask God to root that out. And then I'm gonna close us in a prayer. So here is your moment. God, we are thankful for the many ways you speak to us. And today we ask that you would impart within our hearts a desire to love and bring light wherever we go. Please, please discourage any darkness from within us. Take it out. And in its place, God, put your heart for this world, to redeem it and love it and reconcile it to you. May we be the light and life that people need in the world today. May we be your hands and feet in this world today, oh God. We set ourselves before you and ask that you would make us your ambassadors during this season of difficulty. Give us your grace, give us your love for everyone we meet. In the name of Jesus, amen.
God be with you.
And also with you.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Matthew.
Glory to you, O God.
Jesus left that place and went away to the district of Tyre and Sidon. Just then, a Canaanite woman from that region came out and started shouting, "Have mercy on me, Lord, heir to the house of David. My daughter is tormented by a demon." But Jesus did not answer her at all. And the disciples came and urged him, saying, "Send her away, for she keeps shouting after us." Finally, Jesus turned to the woman and said, "I was sent only to the lost sheep of the house of Israel." But she came and knelt before him, saying, "Lord, help me." He answered, "It is not fair to take the children's food and throw it to the dogs." She said, "Yes, Lord, yet even the dogs eat the crumbs that fall from the table." Then Jesus answered her, "Woman, great is your faith. Let it be done for you as you wish." And her daughter was healed instantly. This is the gospel of hope.
Praise to you, Creator, Christ, and Holy Spirit.
Amen indeed. Please be seated, and if you would again open your hearts and your minds and all that you are into this sacred space, let us pray. Almighty, holy, and blessing one, thank you for your presence in this, your cathedral of hope. Thank you for your presence that illuminates our path and directs us in the ways of truth. So open us now, O God, so that we might hear you, receive you, know that the God that we believe in is a God that is still speaking and who meets us on our journey this day. So bless us in that great abundance, O God, and in your faithfulness and our response, may we hear your voice. And now, O God, I pray that you would touch my lips of clay. Mold them into the words that need to be spoken this day, and may the words that come from my mouth and the meditations on each and every one of our hearts, may they be ever acceptable to you. In the name of Jesus the Christ, in whom we pray. Amen. So as Reverend Aaron said, during our gathering time, we're in a season of generosity, a season of faithfulness, a season in which we are invited to think about how God has remained faithful to us, a season when we begin to think about how we act from that place of faithfulness, and in that act of faithfulness, remind us that we all have a role to play in what is called the Church of Jesus Christ. That each and every one of us, no matter where we are on our spiritual journeys, can find a touch place in our own hearts, in our own lives, where we know that God has been faithful. It may be in a time of great need or in a time of great crisis in our lives, or it may have been in a time of great exaltation and joy. We are able to look back in our lives and to see God's faithfulness to us. I lose count of the number of times in which I am grateful for the way in which God has remained faithful to me, and grateful for the way in which that faithfulness has been expressed, sometimes when I have been living it and sometimes on the other side of an action, when I'm able to look back and to see just where God has been, blessing and anointing and sometimes just holding me in the grace of God's hands. I know that that is the story for many of us here at Cathedral of Hope as we look back in our own lives, or perhaps even at this very moment. Perhaps at this very moment, some of us are going through moments in our lives where we just need the blessed assurance that Jesus is mine, that God is present in all of the actions of our lives. I think we said just a couple of weeks ago that the reality is that if we could change our attitude to where God is in our lives, if we could change our perspective on life itself, perhaps it's in those moments that we see the transforming actions of God at work today. And that each and every one of us, in that sense of faithfulness, in that sense of gratitude, if we could live lives from a place of gratitude, we could then see the place of God's faithfulness. Faithfulness, faithfully living, faithfully creating, faithfully journeying with us through our lives. We can't help but look around at the Cathedral of Hope this morning and just the building itself and not know God's faithfulness to Cathedral of Hope United Church of Christ and the immense contribution that so many have given because they believed in God's faithfulness to this community. I'm grateful for the ways in which you express that faithfulness in so many different ways. And through this season of faithfulness, this season of generosity, we too have an opportunity to claim our stake, to claim our place at the table, and to find how we can then faithfully live for the generation that we exist in today, but most importantly, perhaps for the generations that will come after us, the legacy that we will leave as a congregation and as a people. Knowing that it's from that place, that God-centered space within our own hearts and lives and minds, that we come to this season of generosity. Living, being, hoping, desiring, knowing God's faithfulness in our lives. This morning's scripture reading from the Gospels reminds us of how God has been faithful, perhaps so faithful that God would send Jesus into the world. To give us a living example of that generosity, of that gracefulness, of that faithfulness of God. And yet we might be perceived perhaps a little deceptive this morning from the scripture reading that was read about this woman, this Canaanite woman, who came to Jesus asking for healing. Now, on the surface of this particular scripture, we may just quickly glib over it, but there are some serious theological understandings that we need to know about this particular piece of scripture. First of all, we need to understand that the Canaanite woman was not a Jew. She was a Greco-Roman world. She was from the Gentile population. And if you know anything about Scripture, you know that the Scriptures were written for a Jewish audience, for a Jewish community. And that Jesus' first mission on earth was to reestablish or reconnect or perhaps give a new covenant to the Jewish community. So it's ironic that in this particular Scripture, we have this Canaanite coming to Jesus. Now, the other thing we need to understand is that it was not common for a woman to approach a man. Now, we live in a very different times these days, thankfully. But the truth is that in Jesus' day, it was very unusual for a woman, perhaps even condemned for a woman, to speak to a man unaccompanied by another man. In some ways, there was this culture that women were not seen as equals. Praise Jesus, we live in a different land today, and who knows what might happen in 4 weeks' time. But thank God we're in a different time. Now, of course, I never speak party politics from the pulpit. I want to make that very clear this morning. I'm not endorsing any candidate. I'm not doing any of those things in case anyone would want to take our 501c3 status away from us. But I'm grateful that we live in a different land, a different time than Jesus. And I'm always so grateful for the women in our congregation who stand up and who speak out and who claim their place at the table, just like this Canaanite woman. Let's honor the women of our church this morning. I'm so excited about what's the work that's going to come out of our Women's Council here at Cathedral of Hope and remind us of the equality of women's voices in our faith community. This woman, this Canaanite woman, had no fear, it appears, of calling out for Jesus. In fact, this woman, it says in Scripture, wasn't coming quietly and timidly. It says in Scripture that she came shouting at Jesus. She came out shouting at the disciples, saying, "Hey, look over here. Don't keep walking by this need in this community and in this world." Jesus was obviously very tired and had already done a lot of ministry, but this woman was determined to claim her place at the table. This woman was determined to grab Jesus' attention. And it says in Scripture that she came out shouting at the disciples, shouting at Jesus, "Look over here, there is a woman in need." And it seems perhaps an arrogant response from Jesus, who turns to the woman and says, "But I didn't come for you. I came only for the Jewish nation. I came for another group of people." Sound familiar, Cathedral of Hope? How many in our community today say, "I'm not here for you. I'm not to speak up for you. I'm not of your race or your gender or your gender identity or your sexual orientation or whatever it is that we want to fill in the blank. I didn't come for you. I came for another group of people." And it says that the disciples were so weary of this woman that they went to Jesus and said, "Would you just please tell her to be quiet?" How familiar is that to many of us? How many of us, when we have tried to get our attention or to raise the profile of the values of Jesus or the values of faith within our communities, have we been said, "Oh, just tell them to be quiet. Wait for a little while and it will happen"? Well, praise God, this woman in her persistence did not be dismissed so easily. And she confronts Jesus and says, "But isn't it true that even the dog should take the scraps that fall from the master's table?" I can't imagine what Jesus must have felt in that very moment. You see, many of us lift up this whole sense of the divinity of Jesus and this place that Jesus has with God's self. But in this story that we receive this morning, we see Jesus' humanity. We don't just see his divinity, we see his humanity. And we see the authenticity, the faithfully being of Jesus. I believe with my whole heart that there was a moment of transformation in Jesus' life as this woman confronted him that day. There was a transformation of this new place of authenticity in his life and in his theology that met him through the tenacity and the boldness of this woman in our story. And Jesus was suddenly confronted by the reality that he too, his worldview, his theology was too narrow for what God was really inviting Jesus to do in his life and in his ministry. For it was in this moment that Jesus suddenly realized that there was great need in the other, in those who were on the outside looking in, on those who needed as much healing in their lives as the Jewish peoples, who needed as much love in their lives as those who Jesus felt that he was called to. And it was through the faith of this woman that Jesus' ministry truly began to transform the world. It was beyond just those who were considered the insiders, just those who were considered those that Jesus was called to. Jesus suddenly realized that there was this whole other people who needed the love of God. I don't know about you, but that's good news for Cathedral of Hope. That's good news for people like you and I who have often been seen on the outside looking in. People like you and I who have tried to live authentically who we are as people. And Jesus comes to us this morning and says, we're not asking you just to take the crumbs that come from the table. We're asking you to sit at the banquet and to bring your whole authentic selves to the table of liberation. All that you are. It is the challenge of faithfully being who we have been called to be, to bring our entire selves to the table. Now, many of you know I have a 2-year-old daughter, and she is now starting to recite everything that you say, which means you have to be very careful what you say around Sophia. What has also happened over the last few weeks is that I've started taking Sophia to daycare in the morning. I want to tell you, separation anxiety is not a good thing. And struggling to get her out of the house and into the car seat and then for the traffic through Dallas, which is nothing like Los Angeles, but is still traffic in Dallas, trying to get her to daycare on time is a feat in itself. And what we have begun to do, or what I have begun to do, is to play nursery rhymes on the way into work. Well, there's only so much the wheels on the bus go round and round that you can play. And it does get a little monotonous, perhaps for the drivers around me, when the driver on the bus goes beep, 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 and I press my horn 3 times. I'm sure drivers around me are wondering what on earth I am doing. There is another nursery rhyme that comes on, or a kid's song that comes on, and it's a little different here in the United States than it is in Great Britain. The words are a little bit different, but the meaning is the same. We call it the Okie Cokie, but I don't think that's what you call it. It's that song that says you put your left arm in and your left arm out. Try and do that while you're driving. Lean out, in, out, and shake it all about. Well, I want to tell you the verse that I love is the last piece of the chorus. You put your whole self in, your whole self out. In, out, and shake it all about. Now, you might be asking yourself, why on earth do we call it the Okie Cokie? Well, we call it the Okie Cokie because once you put your whole self in and whole self out and in, out, and shaking it all about, you do the Okie Cokie and you turn around. Now, you can't do that when you're in a car, I promise you. I like to believe that what I'm teaching Sophia as she begins to speak these words is that I'm inviting her to take her whole self, whoever she is, whoever she might become, all that she is, and to bring it to the table, to bring it on, and to allow God do the miracle that God will do when you bring your whole authentic self to the table of liberation, to the table of Jesus. So many of us have been taught not to bring our whole selves. So many have been taught that we must compartmentalize our lives, that we must only put our left hand in or our right hand in or the pieces that we believe are acceptable to God. But just like this Canaanite woman, she was bold enough to say, "Take me as I am, in my boldness, in my tenacity, in perhaps what some people might call rudeness, or what others might call as something less than, and bring it on. Bring my whole self to the table." Not only was Jesus' theology changed that day, but her life was changed. When she realized that she could bring her whole self and bring all of her theological understanding, whatever that was for her, and that somehow that would change Jesus and change the direction of Jesus' ministry, perhaps even change the direction of the early church and of the early theological understandings and statements, when she realized that she could bring herself just as she was, faithfully being what God had created her to be, and in gratitude come to the table, she then found healing in her life. Cathedral of Hope, I believe that we are called to bring our whole selves to the table. Not to compartmentalize, not to leave some of it at the door. Not to believe that somehow if you bring your whole self in, that somehow the heavens are going to burn, send fire down upon us. How many of us have been taught that if we enter into a church that somehow the lightning bolt would come in and strike us because we are so bad in our lives? Well, thankfully, many of us have tested Jesus in these things. And not one of us has seen a thunderbolt. Well, not in church, anyway. We have been called, sisters and brothers, to faithfully be. To bring our whole selves, even if others think that self is unacceptable. And to know that through the God that is still speaking, God will continue to reveal the wholeness of God's faithfulness to the church and to us as individuals as we allow our full selves, our whole being, to come and to worship. Indeed, I believe that the Holy Spirit is only able to do what the Holy Spirit is able to do if we truly do bring our whole selves, and to allow the fullness of God to be revealed in us. For when we leave pieces of us out, it is hard for the Holy Spirit to do the transforming work that the Holy Spirit is called to do. It is hard for the Holy to enter in when we have hidden pieces of ourselves from the divine presence of God. And it is in that faithfulness that God can speak to this generation. I believe that the church has excluded far too many people from the divine grace of God. Some of us were probably hearing on the news this week of a particular congregation here in Dallas who wrote to a young gay man who was in their congregation and telling that person that they are no longer a member of their particular congregation because they would not repent of their sexual identity, their sexual orientation. And he chose a year later to publish that letter on social media. He decided to post it because he knew that the damage that had been done to him was not something he wanted to inflict on others. I want to tell you, sisters and brothers, that always makes me so sad. It sometimes makes me mad, but it definitely makes me sad. It makes me sad that we would use our particular theological position to exclude people from the divine grace of God. It makes me sad that we have done that not just with the LGBT community, but with so many communities. I know that there are some congregations, I know I pick on my leather pew over here on the front row, But I know that there are many congregations around the world who, for our people of leather, church is not a safe space. I also know that there are many places around the world where church is not safe space for women, and not safe space for transgender men and women. I am so grateful that we are able to extend an invitation to people who have been excluded from other places and to bring them home to this new place, this place where we are still open to what God is doing, and this new place where we are still asking people like our leather folk to confront us and to say, I don't need to take the scraps that come from the table. I have a place at the table whether you like it or whether you don't. And to take their place. I love it when I see our leather folk at 9 o'clock once a month doing ushering and taking out the offering, because I know for some of our folks in our own congregation, as liberal as we might think we are sometimes pretty conservative and who confront many of our ideological understandings or theological conceptions. And I know that there are some folks who, even when Reverend Aaron gets up to take communion or to consecrate, still have a thing in their own theological baggage that says, is it really okay for a woman to consecrate communion? Even at Cathedral of Hope, the largest progressive congregation in the world, sisters and brothers, we have yet much, much more to confront ourselves with. Just as the woman who confronted Jesus that day, and in many ways said to Jesus, get over yourself. Believe me, in more than 30 years of ordained ministry, I've had to get over myself many, many times. As people's lives and people's stories have confronted my own theological understanding, and I've come to that place just like Jesus, who said to that woman that day, greater faith have I not seen. Your faith has healed your daughter. Your faith, even when I didn't have faith in you, even when I wasn't sure that this was really a gospel of good news for you, even when I was sure that my theological perceptions and my theological blinkers were truly just my way of believing, were confronted in the reality of a God who still speaks. I invite every single one of us in this congregation to faithfully be who you are, to faithfully know that what you have been created to be is not a mistake, but is a divine invitation and a divine presence of God in the world today. And that in all truthfulness, without you being faithfully who you have been called to be, we have not yet even scratched the surface of what God is doing in the world today through the authenticity of the design of God's creation. Faithfully be. Authentically stand in your place this morning and to give God thanks for just who you are. And know that if God can accept you just the way you are, then God's magic will accept the person next to you, even if you don't understand, to be authentically who they are. And therein lies the good news of Jesus. I look forward to seeing how God will blow our minds here at Cathedral of Hope as people authentically bring themselves to this table and allow the holy, not you and me, we're not called to judge, that's somebody else's job. We're not even called to transform, that's somebody else's job. We are called only to judge ourselves and to allow the holy to do whatever she needs to do in our own personal lives. May that lead us in our quest for life and to confront the systems of oppression that continue to put people down today. I look forward to those who perhaps are not finding a home somewhere else to find it here at Cathedral of Hope. Not that we're looking to sheep steal or to take people from other places or other churches, but we are called to be that place of liberation where God will welcome God's sheep, God's pasture, God's authentic human beings to find their place at the table of grace. God bless you, Cathedral of Hope, and may it be so in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. You put your whole self in. I'm not going to do the dance. I'm going to leave that to him. So on Wednesday nights, we've been in a series called The Habits of Healthiness, and it really coincides with the Sunday series and just talking about ways that we as a congregation and as individuals can better ourselves for the glory of God and for our community and for this world. And this last week, Reverend Aaron spoke on serving, and it also had a lot to do with giving, if you really looked into the message. And she talked about the boy with the fish and the loaves of bread and how it fed over 5,000 people, and there was enough food for this whole massive conglomerate of individuals who were there. And I believe that the reason that there was that much food available wasn't just because it miraculously appeared, but I think that just maybe after they saw this little boy bring what he had and saw that he had brought, you know, everything he was traveling with, that other people started to feel kind of convicted and pulled something out of their satchel or out of their robe and began to give as well. And everything that we need, everything that we need to survive and thrive as a congregation is in this house. And we don't have to go out of these walls and go begging the community for money, because what we have here is enough if we all just begin to do what God has called us to do and listen to our hearts, because scarcity and poverty cannot live in the same place as generosity. And when we have that generosity, that's how we can feed people every Saturday morning. That's how we can feed the homeless and have eye care on Mondays and give out groceries. And that's how we can provide blessing bags. Bless you. That's how we can provide those blessing bags on Wednesday nights to our homeless as well, and do all the amazing, amazing things that we do in this house. So I just can encourage you to be generous and to give and to get a Kleenex for our friend.
Jesus, you're my firm foundation.
be seated. Indeed, we have a firm foundation in Christ. And that firm foundation was established long before the presence of Jesus entered the world. And it's that firm foundation that Jesus encouraged his disciples to live on in the legacy of his own life. And it is in that firm foundation that we come this day as part of that legacy of Jesus in the world. Jesus, who on the night that he was to be taken from them, took bread, gave thanks and praise, blessed it, and broke it, and who passed it around to each and every one of them and said, "Take and eat of this, all of you. For this is like my body, which is soon to be broken apart for you and for many. Take and eat of this as often as you shall do so, but always in remembrance of me," said Jesus. And who in like manner, following supper, took from the table a cup, again gave you thanks and praise and blessed it, and once again passed it around the table to all who had gathered, and who said to them, "Take and drink of this, all of you. For this is a new and everlasting covenant that I make between you and God. Receive this covenant, this promise of the firm foundation upon which we can build our lives. Take and drink of this as often as you shall do so, but always in remembrance of me," said Jesus.
Let us pray. Almighty God, send the power of your Holy Spirit on us, gathered here and on these gifts of grape and grain. Make them for us holy food that nurtures us in body and spirit, that by sharing this feast, we may know the presence of the living Christ. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all of the world. Through Jesus Christ, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory be yours, now and forever. Amen.
Amen. As the lay ministers of worship prepare a table for you, I remind you that this isn't the church's table or our table. This is Christ's table. So if you have little faith or much faith, you've been here often or not hardly at all, if you feel you have been successful, if you feel that you are failing, you are welcome here. Come not because the church or I invite you, but because Christ invites you to this table. And at the usher's direction, know that you are welcome to come. Thank you.
Thank you.
we thank you for this feast that you have provided for us. Send us therefore into the world, fed and ready to feed others. Amen. To God's gracious mercy and protection, each and every one of us is given. And the blessing of God, known to us as Creator, Savior, and Holy Spirit, be with us and remain with us now and evermore. Amen. Amen. Go and faithfully be.